in the street, they call it weather.
All right, hey, what is up, everyone? It is. Whoa, this is a lot of dust. It is 6 p.m. and I'm riding into the heart of the city. This is peak hour traffic. You can see the traffic starting from here all the way up to that junction. So this is peak hour traffic. And I am on the Xpulse, or this Xpulse as I like to call it. You know, whenever I have to ride through the city, there's only one bike that I really crave to ride, and that is this. I mean, today I actually wanted to go and fix the indicator stalk of the RD, but I chose to use this bike instead because I am planning to head further into the city, and this bike just feels a lot more comfortable to ride. Alright, I'm going to shut up since somebody said I talk too much on my videos. So, I'm just going to let you guys see what's happening. Oh. Elbow, nan maga, phone, yella nodkonbittu odstare now. Bike's just been back from a service. This is the second service. No major work done to the motorcycle. Just basic checks and I think some adjustments. Oil hasn't been changed either. My second service bill came up to a huge amount of 403 rupees. This includes chain clean, chain loop, washing the bike, and I think they've cleaned the oil filter and maybe adjusted the chain for slack and maybe done some other stuff like you know, cleaning out the air filter, topping up some oil. Yeah, that's about it. Oh, there's a big jam there. I'm gonna go from inside. So yeah, I've tightened up the clutch as well. And the bike is flying. I think it's probably because they have done up the they've just cleaned up the air filter, I think. What is the purpose of life? Look at this. Every soul shall taste death. But he's spelt it as test death, and this is from the Quran. Wow, this is some deep stuff, man. And this is by Kulsum. Kulsum is probably his daughter or his wife or maybe sister. Kaun to pehne de manje malum nahi par heavy dialogue ba. What is the purpose of life? Can you say me that one? Yeah, so the bike is flying, and I'm pretty happy. You know, this bike is not only you know, super comfortable to ride in the city, great at tackling shitty roads, amazing at splitting lanes, overtaking, not really overtaking, you know, in Bangalore we have this term, I don't know if it's used elsewhere, we call it filtering. Cutting or filtering, cutting and filtering, okay. These are probably terms associated or created by boys who spend a lot of time at tea shops. That's a garbage truck, and I don't want to be anywhere close to it. Unfortunately, this auto is a gas kito curry auto. Yeah, overtaken, brah. Beautiful bike. It's just like, I really don't know what they've done. It feels like they've either remapped it or they've I don't know. It feels like a restriction has been lifted off the bike compared to what it was like to ride. Maybe it's just my imagination. It could be just that the oil filter, the air filter could have been clogged up, because even the oil filter has not been changed, right? And the oil filter on this bike doesn't even have an oil filter, if I remember right. It just is like, it's not a filter that needs to be changed. So, I could be wrong though. It may have a small oil filter that goes on the side, not a big canister like you have on the Interceptor, because obviously the Interceptor has like what, 3300 ml of oil. This has 1300 ml, so almost like one third of it, right? Yeah, bike is running great, it's flying, and I'm really happy with this purchase. It's probably the most sensible purchase I've made in my life. you know, when it comes to motorcycles, sensible in the sense of everyday practicality, you know, for a short while I was using the Interceptor as an everyday ride, and I quickly got tired of it. I have a back issue, I have a back injury that I sustained in a crash about 6 years ago when I broke my back. And to manage the heft of the Interceptor, which is like 200 kgs plus in our stop and go street traffic with these kind of roads, and the stock suspension, just, you know, not happening. So yeah, not to mention the Interceptor is drinks also quite a bit. I mean, in the city you're looking at around 20, maybe a little, maybe more, not less, but yeah, below 30 and above 20. So that's the kind of mileage it gives in the city. Versus this gives me around, I get like 200 kilometers, approximately 200 kilometers. 1913 to 1914. St. Peter's Church. Okay, this is Cox Town Market under the flyover. I had a good friend who stayed around here who's no more. Always think of him when I pass this area. This is a government school or college or something like that. Old part of town. There's an old pub here called Dolphins. Probably one of the oldest pubs here still running. That's a nice funky shirt. So yeah. So with the Interceptor, the weight, the brakes. The brakes are good. With the Interceptor, it was mainly about the weight, the suspension, and then the fact that and the mileage, right? So you would have to fill up gas like every 1-2 days. Giving you an approximate of, say, I fill $500 every time I go to the gas station, right? If for commuting in the city. So $500 in India, in my city, will get you around almost 5 liters, but not really 5 liters, you get around 4.9, okay? So for $500 of gas, on the Interceptor, I think I get less than 100 kilometers in the city, okay? And on the Xpulse, I get close to 200. So it's a big difference. It's almost double. And you don't really have to think about fuel mileage. I mean, look at it. It's on 2 bars. It's been on 2 bars since the last time I took it out, which was like a couple of days back. And I haven't filled gas in it. You don't need to constantly be worrying about filling up gas. That is for sure. Suspension, great. Handling characteristics, brilliant. Suspension is not just great, suspension is mind-blowing. Handling characteristics, brilliant. Maintenance costs, cheap AF. Fuel mileage is efficient AF. So, 5 stars with this bike. Though I must tell you that while I have not really experienced anything negative, in fact the only negative experience I've had with this bike is when I gave this bike for service and I was not very happy with with the way they had sprayed polish over everything, with the way that the pressure wash had blown off a sticker. So this time when I gave it for service, they replaced the sticker. They specifically did not polish it because of my past experience. They did wash the bike and lube the chain because I asked them to do it, and to lube and clean and lube the chain, it is around 50 odd rupees, which is super cheap. And coming to the pros, the cons of this motorcycle, I don't really have any cons to speak of, other than managing the height, which if you learn how to do it, it isn't a problem. Another con of the side stand, but these are all, the side stand is like almost upright and so the motorcycle can tilt. These are not really cons, these are just things that you have to adjust with, right? You have to learn. So now when I park the bike, I always look for a part of the road that has a slight incline, so then look at this guy. This is hazardous, man. But a lot of people complain about, I've been reading a lot of posts on online forums where people are complaining about oil leaks and engine failures and stuff like that, and oil leaking from the tappet covers. And basically suggesting that the bike doesn't have great build quality. I haven't faced any of those issues yet, touch wood, and I hope I don't. Yeah, in my eyes, there's nothing wrong with this motorcycle. And also, the kind of reliability issues that these people seem to be complaining about. I mean, this motorcycle is not a highly stressed motorcycle. Hero's been building this platform for years. If I'm not mistaken, this engine platform comes from the Glamour. So, I mean, it's not rocket science. There's no cutting edge, radical technology being used in this. That is super expensive if things go wrong. No, nothing like that. So, yeah. I personally don't have any issue with the quality. Though it's been a very short time for me to actually comment, because I've run this motorcycle about 1700 kilometers, less than 2000, so it's a little too early for me to say anything in terms of that hey, this bike is bulletproof and nothing can go wrong. But this has been my experience so far, so I'm just giving you that. So we left at 5:58, I think, and it is 6:14 now. And we are we're almost on MG Road. I mean, we have one more signal to cross and we're on MG Road. So, oh God. These are the new Japanese signals. You can see these signals with polythene bags on them. Supposed to be the new Japanese technology to improve our traffic congestion. You can see some more over there. Must have bought this as a bomb, for a bomb. But yeah. So yeah, there's just something I've been thinking about. Our Indian cities are getting so congested. Bangalore's already one of the most congested cities in the world. Pune is like closely behind. The reason for all this is our governing authorities never had the foresight to build adequate infrastructure to sustain the kind of growth that a population of over a billion people would see. So what you have now is basically in these kind of cities like Bangalore, which was like, Bangalore was essentially a British cantonment, with a lot of educational institutions that attracted a lot of non-resident Indians, children here to study in their numerous engineering and medical colleges and what have you. And with that vast talent pool, there obviously was going to be a lot of industries that were sprout out, and so the IT boom happened. And hold on. So he's riding with his phone in his hand. What a talented fellow, yeah. Diddle. Sometimes I also do that too. Yeah, here is where. Yeah, so I was just telling you about my usual gripe, which is infrastructure. I mean, I've seen the city grow from through the 90s. I would say when I finished my schooling in 2000, the city was at its best. It had the right mix of modernity and heritage and old school Bangalore, right? In till the year 2000, the change of the millennium. The Y2K bug, do you guys remember that? When they said that all the computers around the world would crash and all of that. Yeah, and I think India had something to do with cracking that, and Bangalore specifically, because Bangalore is the IT hub of the city. And yeah, after the IT boom started, it's just been a race. It's just been a race of playing catch up. You know, infrastructure is always behind the rate of growth. And so you will look at this guy. He stopped here because he has to pick up somebody. Yeah, because the amount of people that are coming into this city from other parts of India are immense. You know, because of the job opportunities that are being created here, but the infrastructure is not able to keep pace with it. So you have constant construction activity. I don't know if you can see from here, but there's like, they've dug up the road over there. There's metro work happening right next to my place. They have this, you know, kind of scene where they go into something called white topping, which is concreting road like this, and makes no difference to the traffic because people are buying cars every day. You know, there are thousands of vehicles, brand new vehicles, that hit the roads of Bangalore every day. So city infrastructure is literally crumbling. I could go in from there. Actually, let's see. Yeah. And this seems to be the story with every Indian city. Crumbling, a story of crumbling infrastructure. Oh wow, that's also jammed. Inside gullies help you beat the gridlock. So yeah. You see all this? This is all concrete. So yeah. Take a right. So yeah, all right, I've reached my destination. I will talk to you guys soon.